So good morning, everyone. My name is Sérgio Bernardes. I'm a dentist. I'm here from Brazil. I work at our training center, Ilapel, and I work on the new product development at Neodent. But today I'm here not to talk about me or not to talk about what we do. You're here to know a little bit about Dr. Eva Milinkovic. I did it right? Yes?
Exactly right.
Thanks, Doc. So Dr. Eva, she's a periodontics and she's assistant professor at the Belgrade School of Dental Medicine, right?
Right. Thank you, Sergio, for having me here, and good morning. How is it in Brazil this morning?
Well, it's really good. Really early in the morning. I think that you are close to your lunchtime, is it?
We're about it. We're approaching it and we're having a beautiful sunny day. Apart from that, as you said, being a periodontist, I have to mention that today is the International Gum Health Day. It will be nice to remind both our colleagues and our patients on how important periodontal healthcare is. Therefore, I think our topic that you have chosen today is a good topic that fits International Gum Health Day.
Great, wonderful. That's nice to hear. That's new. I didn't know about it. What a nice coincidence.
Yeah.
Great. So, well, Eva, now let's start with our interview. And I would like to talk about soft tissue management, especially because we know perimplantitis is quite a big challenge for us. And according to your experience, what is the most common causes of factors related to perimplantitis?
Well, thanks to novel classification by EFP and AAP from the end of 2017 and published in 2018, we now have the clear and equivocal definition of perimplant health, perimplant mucositis, and perimplantitis that are conditions affecting our implants. Unfortunately, this is the reality. We are facing perimplant related complications. And as you know, and all of us know, perimplantitis is the most common biological complications around dental implants. To make it brief, it's usually biofilm plaque induced, and there are several local or systemic conditions that may contribute to it. Systemic conditions, disorders that we all know that interfere with healing and bone metabolism, but local conditions are uncontrolled periodontal disease, low level of oral hygiene, which we really need to stress out because patients that do not maintain their oral hygiene are not an indication for dental implant treatment. We need to remind ourselves and our patients. So, and since there are many other contributing unfortunately iatrogenic factors such as bad 3D implant positioning that we really need to take care of all the time when we are planning our implant cases in all three dimensions, then the way the implant is prosthetically restored, the proximity to other structures, cement retained versus screw retained. So there are like really so many factors going on and putting together that may lead to complications. And nowadays, we do know that complications occur, and they occur in vast variety of prevalence. They may go up to 50% of cases. So that's why we need to take care to prevent them, then to early diagnose them, and to properly treat them, right?
Great, perfect. I have a question that I usually I heard it from a lot of my students. Okay, if your patient has a periodontal disease, do you believe that a person with a periodontal disease has more chances to have perimplantitis, or a patient with periodontal disease in the past? Let's say it wouldn't be that he wouldn't have more chances to have perimplantitis in the future. What do you think about it?
Well, you know, Sergio, many, many studies have been done on that. And both you and me are treating periodontally compromised patients with implants on an everyday basis. what is definitely defined also by ITI consensus from 2014, periodontitis is a risk factor for perimplantitis. And those patients tend to develop more implant-related complications. Nonetheless, of course, that patients are suffering periodontitis, and of course, that patients are losing teeth. So it doesn't mean that we will risk their quality of life and do not provide them with quality implant prosthetic treatment. What is important is to control periodontal disease, to maintain it under control, and to take special care with these patients when we place implants, to enroll them in a supportive care and to recall them for maintenance, maybe more often, just to take special care to have this inflammation under control. Same as periodontal disease, my really honest belief, and it is also in accordance with the literature and books we learn, is that we need to care that inflammation is under control all the time. So we need to see our patients more often and do supportive care and even reinforcement and re-enhancement of oral hygiene whenever we see it's needed.
Great, wonderful. Well, I really love this combination between patients with implants and follow-up. I think that that's one of the most important things when it comes to oral implant treatment.
We really need it. Yes. I don't know how is it in your country, but in my country, patients like to get the work done and like say goodbye. So it's our duty, being all kinds of dental professionals, to take care of our patients. First, to explain them the importance of oral health, and then to maintain it. To achieve it, and then to maintain it.
Exactly the same. It's our duty to, you know, keep their mind always thinking about it. Absolutely. Well, when it comes to perimplantitis and implant surface, do you have any relation between implant surface and perimplantitis? And if yes or no, why?
There is a relation, in my modest opinion, there is a relation of perimplantitis with everything. About surface, we need to stick to documented surfaces. Mm-hmm. So the augmentation and roughening of the surface on micro level has been designed in order to enhance osseointegration. Mm-hmm. Both of us know that SLA surface is the most documented surface in the literature, since we have data now to up to 30 years of the research. But also the enhancement of this surface by making it hydrophilic in order to attract blood cells and to enhance healing that would enhance and fasten the osseointegration would theoretically and practically, that we know on our everyday basis, prevent further bone loss. So better and faster osseointegration that some hydrophilic surfaces that some implant systems, fortunately that one that we are using, both of us provide us, are in favor of better and faster osseointegration than better soft tissue maintenance, and thus preventing bacterial invasion and potential perimplant complications.
Great, thanks for your answer. Well, when it comes to the treatment itself for perimplantitis, in which situations do you recommend surgical or non-surgical treatments of perimplantitis, patients with perimplantitis?
Wow, I was hoping not to have this question. I hope you won't ask me in which situation you're gonna guarantee 100% treatment success. Now, you know, the aim of the treatment is of course to control by cleaning implant surface. Cleaning threaded implant surface is not an easy task. So what I can say in perimucositis, are defined as a reversible inflammatory condition that does not affect bone, we can go for non-surgical treatment. In perimplantitis cases, only in those cases in which we do not have severe bone loss or access implant surface and control inflammation in a conservative way. But unfortunately, most of the cases need surgical treatment. Some of the cases I do need to mention in this bone loss and not responding to the treatment, have a treatment as a treatment option, also implant removal and go all over again. We need to try to prevent this happen, but that's why I need to go back to your first question and stress out how important is good implant and prosthetic planning in terms of implant selection, macro design, micro design, implant connection, abutment connection, prosthetic reconstruction, properly placed and restored implant in periodontally controlled patients and systemically healthy patients are running lower risk of developing complications. But to go back to your questions, just to summarize it, in all those cases in which we cannot access the surface and clean it, and in which we have deeper peri-implant defects, we need to open up and see what's going on there.
Now, well, it's a tricky question now, because... so
another one.
Yeah, yes. Yes, I love this topic. But, well, basically, it's more or less like this, because unfortunately, we don't have that much scientific consensus on perimplantitis. There's still a lot of discussion, right? And but now I would like to hear from basically your clinical experience, okay? Do you see more cases of perimplantitis when you have treatments made on the implant level or on the abutment level?
What do you mean? Are you talking about tissue level and both bone, or talking about transmucosa?
I'm talking about an implants with in the bone level, but you know, some people they do the restorations directly on the implant, and some people do the restoration on the abutment level. So based in what you believe and what you see, do you see a difference between this and the periodontal disease, or you don't see it?
Well, it is a tricky question, because we need to take special care and in abutment selection and proper prosthetic reconstruction. Mm-hmm. So both implant and abutment level reconstructions can work well, but it depends on how deep an implant has been placed, how are the bony peaks around this implant. And I really think that we do need answers that I personally don't have, and I'm wondering if you do have, on a perfect design and height of transmucosal profile of the reconstruction, independently whether it is implant or abutment level. But we really need to have sufficient support by transmucosal part of the reconstruction to the surrounding soft tissue in order to make a mucosal seal or soft tissue locking to prevent further bone loss. So properly placed implant with a proper transmucosal design that we can now be plain, conical or convex, and those critical and subcritical contours are gonna give us really a lot of responses on how to deal with our patients. We all I personally tend to uh-huh. have sufficient soft tissue around, sufficient bone around, and uh-huh. by not doing all at the same time, like one miracle at the same time, augment the bone and then go with an implant placement, and then before or after or in augment soft tissues. But then on the other hand, in the aesthetic zone, when we have to do everything at the same time, and novel implant designs provide us with these possibilities. But still, we need to know really which transmucosal design and which transmucosal height are we going to choose for individual case in order to maintain this soft and hard tissue stability.
Thanks for your frank answer. I really appreciate it. Cool. Yeah, and in the end of the day, this is how we do science in healthcare. We don't have, you know, like 2 + 2 is not always equal to 4, so it's really tough sometimes.
Unfortunately, and you cannot use the same 2 + 2 formula in 2 patients. That's the problem. Every patient needs individualized profile and planning. That's
absolutely.
Yeah.
Great. So, yes, please.
I think we will be there soon. Come on, the research is going the good way. Technology is developing. You are in biomaterials. I mean, on a from the mechanical point of view, many things are emerging in a positive way. From a biological point of view, we're still searching for answers, but trying to do our treatments as biologically good as possible. So I think we're on a good way. I don't know what you think.
I really agree with you on the top. We have much more and more patients being treated with oral implants nowadays than if you compare, let's say, the population use of implants like 20 years ago. We have much more patients being treated with implants nowadays, which is good. Since our colleagues, when they do it properly, that's very good.
Exactly.
It's turning more democratic, let's put it this way. Well, since we're talking about implant abutments and designs, when you think about conical connections, okay, when you think about conical connections, implants with a conical connection, implant abutment connection, which benefits do you believe that that this kind of connection could be positive for prevention of a perimplantitis?
Well, as we know from the literature, conical connection is gaining really importance in terms of micro gap elimination and stability of the connection. Additionally, I have to mention the novel Neodent helix connection with a changed conicity and with a deep conical connection that distributes occlusal forces towards the whole body of the implant, not maintaining it only in this poor coronal and transmucosal parts that are suffering a lot. Might also our patients and their treatments might benefit from these deep conical connections as well. But really conical connections that enable stability of the connection over time and with different, really, really the vast difference of abutment designs that we can choose with these connections, I think it might lead us to a key to success, not just in the aesthetic zone where we're also always talking about aesthetic zone, aesthetics and stability, but both stability of soft and hard tissues we do need in all the zones. So I think with conical connections and its mechanical features, we're on the right track.
Okay, great. Well, we're talking about I think that 15 minutes more or less on things that we love to do, right? Sometimes we spend much more time of our life doing these things, which is basically dentistry and oral implantology, than actually taking care of our personal lives, right? Well, maybe our viewers would like to know a little bit about not Dr. Eva, but also actually from Eva Milinkovic, and what you like to do in your spare time, what you do in your daily basis, I mean, your daily life.
Oh, Sergio, I don't know what about the situation in Brazil, but during this COVID pandemic thing, we actually all faced some free time we were not aware of before. Because unfortunately, I really love my work and I'm both doing university, clinical activity, teaching and science. So it really takes a lot of my time. On the other hand, I love sports, so I'm almost by being constricted in this pandemic time, my workout routine really increased a lot. What I'm missing now, and I really hope we're going back to, is some culture. Theater and author movies are my cup of tea. But let's say outdoor sports, I like skiing, I like snowboarding. I would love to come to Brazil and learn some windsurfing or kitesurfing someday. And hopefully it's gonna happen.
Yes. Well, here in Brazil, the press is talking about the new common. That's how more or less it will be the translation. We are having a new common life soon. It will be a little bit different than what we are used to, but for sure, we will get to this soon.
We were organizing this new common life. You know, this gave us opportunity to talk much more to our friends, to maybe not to see them in person, but I really kind of had some time to see how people feel, what would people like to do, what did you read, or what would you like to read, discuss some topics that have nothing to do with dentistry. And there is plenty of topics out there, Sergio, that we forgot about it. So you go. You can run into a discussion about politics, economy, global crisis, or even some book or film. We do need that. Come on.
Absolutely. That's right. That's right. So, well, looking forward maybe to see you one day here. That would be really nice, doing your kite surfing. I can give you nice tips in Brazil.
Thanks, so much. Thanks for the recommendations in advance. When we get used to it, no common thing. Yeah. Common live.
Well, now we get to a part of the our show where we do what we call the ping pong questions. Okay, basically the ping pong questions are dynamic. So I give you two options based on the things you spoke to us, and then you can say one on the other, and you can explain a little bit why you choose this or the other. Okay.
Cool.
Right. Okay, so let's start with this. Okay, let's put it this way. If I would put it like you, okay, so you are the patient right now, yeah, and you have a couple of implants in your mouth, okay, and you have two your teeth. What would you prefer to have, periodontal disease or peri-implant disease?
You know, Sergio, being periodontist by most of my dental life and starting with peri-implantitis just recently, I prefer periodontal disease up to now.
More chances of treatment, right? More story, more science, let's say.
Yeah, but if I find some really, really relevant answers to peri-implantitis, then I will switch my tasks. But no, really, joking apart, it's really important to maintain our teeth as far and as long as possible. When it's not possible, we really nowadays have great opportunities to replace them with functional and successful prosthetic implant retained restorations. But
yes, that's true. Well, and now when it comes to bone loss, and I know you know, I think you noticed, right? I'm making it hard for you.
No, I don't know what you're talking about.
So when it comes to bone loss around implants, okay, do you believe that we have much more reasons behind based on biomechanics or microbiology?
Both. Definitely both, because we are a kind of separating biological from biomechanical complications. And I'm really happy to start seeing now publications regarding occlusion forces and mechanical forces diagnosed. As I maybe mentioned before, I really think we cannot speak separately about soft tissues and hard tissues. We need to put them together. That's the same. We cannot talk about oral microbiota and plaque families without occlusal forces. A colleague of mine at some meeting had a word like, are we facing the era of overloaditis or something like that? So like, We have our companies that are providing us mechanically stable implants and their components, but we really need to take into consideration how we deal with force distribution together with microbes that are all around us. So it's definitely the cross, how do you say it in English? It needs to be taken into consideration together.
Yeah. Great. And I fully agree with you, by the way. And now during your interview, you were talking about implant positioning, okay? So now it's my last ping pong question. When you're placing an implant, you rather place it at the bone level or infrabone level?
At the bone level or subcrestally?
Infrabone level.
Bone level. Well, depends on an implant. If we're talking about tissue level implant, it's not going to be it's going to be placed where it needs to be. But no, honestly speaking, I like to place it subcrestally. There with novel implant designs and with platform switching and conical connection components, I feel better in maintaining surrounding soft tissues and bone. We can discuss, and I can ping pong you the question, how deep are you going to go with your implant? And is it really okay to place your implant like 5 millimeters deep in order to ensure your stability and so on? But then this interview would last until tomorrow morning, and I think you need to go and see some patients and me as well. But slightly subcrestally in my hands. You?
You know, I think we need a new show to talk about it.
But switch roles, please. I'm going to be the interviewer.
Okay. Well, for me, I'm with you. When it comes to, I think that we have a big tendency nowadays to go towards subcrestal because, like you explained, the implant designs, they are making it more, you know, they're making it better for us to place the implant subcrestal. That's a big tendency nowadays. And I'm exactly the same. I mean, I like to go subcrestal, but not that much. Especially because sometimes you don't have options of abutments, abutments options. So when people ask me how deep you will want to place your implants, I say it depends on the system. Let's see which options of abutments the system offer, and based on this, I can, you know, I kind of limit my subcrestal positioning, but I don't like also to go that deep. I'll say that.
Yeah, and also, you know, also the ratio, I see now going like really 5, 6, 7 millimeters and saying like I'm moving my connection really far away. It's not, we do not have rational for this.
Yeah. In Portuguese, we have a quote that we say, not 8 and neither not 80. So, you know, stay in the middle.
Exactly. I agree.
Well, it was a really nice conversation nowadays with Dr. Eva Milinkovic from Belgrade. It was really fun, really nice. And I need to say, you know, it's really nice when we see lady doctors, women, you know, working hard and getting to high levels in dentistry. I definitely would like to see more and more woman doctors making implantology with us. And I'm really glad to know you, to meet you today, and to see that you're doing a great work back in your country with your patients. So thanks for your time. I'm really looking forward to see you in person one day. And now I handle the talk to you if you want to say some final words, final considerations to our viewers.
Thank you, Sergio, so much for your invitation. And I really, I'm in line with you. I think, and I know many women that are practicing implant dentistry in a really great way. So we're there, and we're going to stay there. It's really, I like this morning talks that you are leading, and I hope you continue also after this Corona time, because it's nice to have a colleagues exchange some ideas and thoughts, and I wish you luck with that. So hope to meet you in person soon, and thank you once again. It was a pleasure for me.
Great. Thank you very much indeed. Well, keep safe, and we keep in touch. See you. Good morning.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.